My name is Mark LeFay. I just recently moved back to the U.S. from Japan. I worked at the Bank of Tokyo Mitsubishi UFJ in foreign exchange, which is Q and KDB. And I'm currently here as a consultant working at a large investment bank in order to Boston here. And one of the things I really like in this world is Q and KDB. Another one is wine. So I thought, why not bring the two together somehow? So this is a picture to get you thinking about how wine tastes, how wine looks like. And the topic of this is, how can we teach a machine to appreciate wine? And by appreciate wine, I'm being a little bit sarcastic. I really want to use KDB and some machine learning techniques to differentiate wine, one wine from another. And can I have a show of hands? How many people know anything about machine learning? Okay, that's a good bit. This is a very elementary and basic machine learning algorithm I'm going to show. It's under the unsupervised category. Generally speaking, machine learning falls into three different kinds of categories. Supervised learning, where you know what the answer is and you have some kind of algorithm that gives out the answer, and if it's not right, you say, bad boy. You propagate some errors back into it and give you the right answer. Unsupervised learning is, I don't know what the right answer is, you figure it out and tell me. And reinforcement learning is like how you teach your children. Your child might go to touch the stove and you say no and you hit his hand, so that's a negative feedback to him. Or he might eat some broccoli and you might reward him with something good. So positive and negative feedback, that's reinforcement learning. Another way of grouping machine learning is by the similarity of the algorithms. What are they trying to accomplish? Regression, linear, logistic regression is a very common thing to try to do. Clustering and classification, neural networks, and many, many different kinds of AI are out there, self-driving cars. So unsupervised learning, just digging into it a little bit, uses a data set of known inputs but unlabeled outputs. So technically speaking, in a true application, it's really not possible to know whether your algorithm is doing the right thing, because there is no correct output. You don't know what it is. These are very useful for things like determining what are the current topics that are trending in the news. Before you have your Google news feed and hook it up to the world, you don't know what the topics are, and you don't know how many there are. So you just have to trust that the algorithm is going to give you the right number and the right kinds of data. And basically what it does is it infers a function from the data and comes up with some kind of transformation. And these are all kinds of typical problems, classification and clustering. This is an example of clustering. Anomaly of fraud detection, this is used all over the place in credit cards. If you ever use a Visa or Amex, there is certainly some kind of unsupervised AI that's looking at your transactions to determine whether they're valid or not. It's used a lot in image processing and topic modeling, as I said. This is a very, very basic algorithm called K-means. It's also called Boyd's algorithm. And the idea is you have these data points and you want to determine the best clusters to assign these data points. So we start out with n d-dimensional data points, x1 up to xn. We want to partition those n observations into k sets. K must be less than or equal to n. If it's actually equal to n, it's not a very interesting problem. And sometimes you really care that it's k, and sometimes you care that it's k or less. I'll give you an example. If you wanted to size t-shirts, you could take measurements of all the human beings that live in New York, and you say, I want to have a small, a medium, and a large. So you absolutely have to have three different sizes. Or it might be the situation that you just want to come up with no more than three. It depends on your application. And what you want to find is a grouping S that minimizes the distance from the cluster center to the distance measurement. So at a high level, you can think of this as trying to draw kind of circles around these points and making the lines within these circles be the minimum distance. And that's the mathematical expression for this operation. using a Euclidean distance measurement. A Euclidean distance measurement is just like if you had a right triangle, that's the angled line. Of course, when you have many, many dimensional data, it's that with hyperplanes instead. But it's not the only distance measurement. There are multiple other kinds of measurements like Manhattan distance or Mahalalobach. This is used a lot in practice because it's very simple. This is Roy's algorithm. It's very easy to implement. And I'll just walk you through it. It's a heuristic algorithm. It's not one that you can just apply a mathematical function like you could linear regression and get back your least squares, which is LSQ. It's an iterative heuristic. So the first point, the first thing that you have to do, step zero, is initialize your centroids. And there's many different ways you can do this. One way of doing it is just pick points at random. So if you have k equal to 3, you pick 3 of your input points and then start from that. There are different ways and they have different benefits and merits. And then you iterate these following two steps until you get to convergence. So you assign the data points to the closest center, and then you calculate mean centroids. That's it. It's very simple. But to show it, maybe showing a visual representation will give you the intuition a little bit better. So this is a two-dimensional graph, so they're only two dimensions. They are three clusters of random points. So the first step I do, step zero, is initialize three centroids. So I pick three of these points at random, and then I assign the clusters. The clusters, the centroids, are the round markers, and the diamond shapes are the actual input points, and the colors denote the closest centroid. So you can see that the numbers in the centroids are greatly different. It doesn't really matter how many you have, but since I generated this data randomly, I made sure that there's three groupings. And you can see that some of them, like this green one, because of the distance of these two points, this one got very few, while this got a lot. Now, as I go through this, just keep your eye on the round dots. Once we've done that assignment, we calculate new centroids. So you can see that the green circle moved into the middle of that green cluster. And you can see that the red one got pulled down quite a lot, down and to the left. And the blue dot got pulled down into the right. When I redo my cluster assignments, I can see that some of the reds were pulled into the green, and some of the blues were pulled into the red. And we just iterate this until it converges. We calculate new centroids, do the cluster assignments, and now we've reached the point where we converge. Nothing will change anymore. So it's very simple. Now let's look at a real data set. This is a data set on wine. I believe this is an Italian wine. You can get the data from the UCI machine learning repository. There's 178 instances of the wine. And there's 13 different chemical analyses that were done on the wine. Some of them are actually not chemical analysis, but color intensity and hue, and the rest of them are all some sort of chemical analysis. So this is a real-world data set, so it's not going to be as clean and as pretty, but it's really good to look at real data. So let's take a quick look at the raw wine data set. Here are 9 samples. I pulled 3 from each category. Can anyone look at this table and tell me some pattern in the data?
First
line
is
like
1, 2, 3.
Yes, the first column is actually not part of the analysis. It's not the script of the right answer. But that's very good. How about these other numbers? Can you see a pattern?
Yes.
Very good. Keep
the second to last.
Keep that in mind, yeah? Keep that in mind. That's good. So you can do this, you can eyeball it, but it's actually pretty difficult to do with just raw table data. It's very difficult to do. Humans aren't designed to pick out these nuances. So let's run it through this algorithm. The next thing you want to do is to try to understand your data. By looking at a table, you can get some intuition, but it's best to use some kind of visual means. And this is what's called a box plot, and it can tell you a lot of interesting things about your data. They're useful for comparing distributions. They're non-parametric, so it doesn't assume that it comes from a normal distribution, as you often do in quantitative finance. The box in the middle, the left-hand most line, blue line, is the first quantile. The red line in the middle is the second quantile, which is actually the mean of your data. And the right-hand blue line on that box is the third quantile. And then you have these whiskers that are going out to the minimum and the maximum. So can anyone tell me something interesting about these box plots? Something about our data? That's absolutely right. If you were to plot this in 13 dimensions, you'd go insane because it's very difficult to draw in 13 dimensions. But when you do the box plot and you look at these attributes or these features independently using box plot, it's pretty easy. So we can say that this has completely different scales. One of the things we could do is we could normalize all these data, but I'm not going to do that just for this talk. So let's drop that one. Let's drop that one and look at the rest of the data. Any other observations? Yes, there's a different one. So the one that we dropped is called proline, and it's some chemical that I don't know what it is. This one is magnesium, and again, it's a different scale, but maybe it's an order of magnitude off of the rest ones, where the previous one was like two orders of magnitude off. We have these pluses up here, so these pluses are outliers. We have some outliers in this data. And it's hard to tell from the other ones. So we can drop that one as well. So now we've dropped the proline and magnesium. And now we're looking at the rest of the features, and now we see a few outliers. This guy looks relatively normal. The size of the whiskers are kind of roughly the same. The box looks good, the red line looks where it should be in the middle of the box. But some of them don't. This one looks very skewed, malic acid. So some outliers way up here, and then the data is heavily left skewed. So by using these graphical methods, you can get some idea about your data.
Could you get them all on one page if you normalize their means and their variances?
Yes, you can. And actually, it really depends on your data, but that usually helps you in classification problems, in machine learning in general, but not always. Another plot that you can look at, which I recommend looking at, is called a QQ plot, which is a quantile-quantile plot. And rather than ask you questions about it, I'll just tell you. On the left-hand side is alcohol, and it's showing you that it's quite normal. It's showing you the actual data versus how it fits on a normal scale. But it shows you visually, so as long as it's on that 45 degree angle line, and the dots are kind of heavily clumped in the center and lightly on the side, it looks quite normal. Whereas you look at this one, I believe this one is the malic acid. You can see it's heavily kurdiplatic, or platykurtic, right, platykurtic. It means it's non-normal, and it has light tails compared to a normal distribution. So it's always a good idea to try to wrap your head around your data before just throwing it at some algorithm. So this is the Q code. It's not the most glamorous Q code that's ever been written. The first line, we're reading in a CSV file. We're parsing it. The first line, the first column is J, so that's an integer, it's a long. The rest of them are floats, and then we're going to use the dictionary format there, and we're just going to call it A, B, C, D, E, F, G, all the way out. The dot Q dot A is just a list of all the 26 upper layer characters. And then when I slice off the actual groups, we just take the first column, that's going to be, we're just going to store it away so we can see, test our results. And then I reassign them random groupings. And then I create a function and then I converged that function. So this was, when I was doing this presentation, one of the FT guys told me about the converge function. And it's kind of like over, but it does exactly what it says it does, it converges. So I like this function, but you should be certain that your function or your algorithm will converge. As long as it will converge, then you can use this, and it will just keep looping until the data doesn't change. And that's pretty cool. The data doesn't change. The data could be a table, it could be a dictionary, it could be an atom list, it could be anything. As long as it doesn't change, as long as it is changing, it will go through this converge function. So I thought that was pretty cool. And then what we're doing, we create a function, we do a select, and then we're taking the average. This is calculating the centroids first, where the group name is G, and then I do an assignment. This is basically subtracting each data point from each centroid. And then I raise them all and then pass it into this lambda function where I find the minimum distance. The minimum distance is where that point will be assigned. A little bit hairy, but not compared to other things. You just want to find, basically the thing is find the minimum distance and assign the minimum distance to the cluster. And so it's pretty neat that you can, in Q, you can write this in just a few lines of code. At this point, in 16 minutes, I will doesn't look great. There's no graphical. There's no nice graphs coming out of this. But this is the cost function, and it just converges that down. It runs through all of those.
Can you make it bigger?
Yes. Some distance of each centroid to each individual point. And you can see it converge quite quickly upon the triangle. So that's it. Another thing that you can do is principal component analysis. Has anyone ever done principal component analysis? Okay, so what principal component analysis is a statistical procedure that allows you to take really big multi-dimensional data and squash it down into fewer dimensions. This is really, really useful in quant finance. It's used a lot in interest rates. So if you're I'll just give you a generic example. If you're trying to model that term structure, the interest rates are all going to change, but there is some kind of relationship between them. You're not going to have the short rate jump up five interest rates and then 1 month interest rate drop and the next one go up. There's a movement to it. So if you do a principal component analysis on a forward curve, you can see that there's the first principal component is almost always an up and down movement in interest rates across the board. The second principal component is usually a twist in the interest rate. And the third principal component is generally some kind of butterfly effect. So if you have 30 tenors, you can compress all that data down into just three. the level of rates, the steepness of the rates, and the butterfly effect, and you can greatly reduce your beta. If you reduce it down to 2, you can plot out this paper. If you can reduce it down to 3, then you can move it around in three-dimensional space and look at the data. So it's very useful for doing things like that. It takes data that might be correlated, like the GDP in Ireland might be correlated with the GDP of England. So there might be some underlying factor that affects both of those countries in the same way that will that might be invisible. It might be a latent variable. And the word does decorrelation for you. So it separates out all the things, it creates some different axis, which may come out at any angle to the original axis, but it captures the most amount of variation. So the key point here, I'll go through this quickly, is it's just going to reduce the dimensionality of our data. So instead of looking at 13 dimensions, I can show it to you on a much smaller scale. I can draw it up straight. So these are the 13 original features in my data set. When I run the principal component analysis, I can see that proline is the first component one, and just as this gentleman identified in the first one, it seemed to have a very predictive power over what the result is. So you can see that the principal component, the first principal component, which contains the most amount of variance, explains the output the most, the best. It's almost entirely proline. The second principal component is the red one, and that's magnesium. And then if you go to the third one, we start getting all kinds of different effects. We've already explained probably 80-90% of all the variance in our data. The third one has a little bit of color intensity and some alkalinity of ash. So the things that don't have any flat parts don't really predict what the output is. Now that we've reduced it, we can try to visualize the data again. So instead of having 13 dimensions, I can replot all that data on just the first two principal components. This is principal component one, and that's principal component two. The question is, how are these related to our original axes? I've redrawn the original axis in the blue line. So you can see proline is almost collinear with the x-axis. So that explains the peak and the proline. And then the magnesium is slightly skewed from the y-axis. But if you look at the data points, that's what we really want to look at. We can see that they're kind of, roughly speaking, shaped in an oval. So if we had to guess on our line, I would ask for what's the proline and what's the magnesium. And I don't care about those. Because I can probably guess what it is from those two. If you wanted to go one more, you can plot it three dimensions. It gets a little harder to see. Here's proline, here's magnesium, and color intensity, and the other one was alkalinity of ash. So those come out in the third dimension. It's really just a way of visualizing the data. Now, if you plot all those points after we've done the clustering, we can plot them in two dimensions, and we can see this. We can see what this thing did in 13-dimensional space. We can actually see it in two. So the principal component, think proline. Then the second principal component, think magnesium. You can see how this cluster goes together. And it wasn't perfect. There was still some error in the analysis. That's because this is real data, and a lot of times you're not going to get 100%. But I think there was approximately like a 15% error rate loss, which is not bad on completely like raw data. And this isn't a particularly fancy algorithm, it's just an easy one. And so let's relook at those same 9 samples. And I've highlighted the principal components again. You can see that the first principal component was in blue. And yeah, hey, now that you pointed out to me, I can see what this gentleman was talking about, just by looking at the data, he was able to determine this. But by doing that analysis and trying to run some visualizations on it, and reapplying the knowledge that I learned from the visualizations to the original data, I can see the patterns of that. So you know, these are greatly lower than those two. So the first principal component, second principal component, and the combination of these two is your third principal. So key means is not perfect. It suffers a couple weaknesses. So when I was giving this presentation, I took a question from the audience, which isn't always good. And they said, well, what if you had a million? And off the cuff, I didn't want to do a million, so I did 100,000. So I kept the 13 dimensions. Instead of 179, I'm going to randomly take 100,000 data points. So you can see how this scales. It takes about 20 seconds to run. Now this is a massive amount of data that it's calculated. So you got 100,000 times 3 times the number of attributes that we have is 13. So it takes a while to converge, but it does. So that took 21 seconds. So that's one of the weaknesses. It's not the fastest algorithm in the world. Another weakness of the algorithm is that K is the input. So in applications where I want a small, medium, large, great. In an application like, I want to separate my clients into toxic, friendly, and okay. I know that my pricing engines, I have 3 pricing engines, I can only price 3 different groups. That's fine. I know what K is. But sometimes I don't know what K is. I've got an infinite number of servers, I could individually price each client in my from exchange spot system, but I want the best. There are other algorithms like XMEs, or there's a variety of other ones that kind of try to come up with a better answer for what the input is. It does have sensitivity to initialization, so if you pick particularly bad input, bad initializations, it can give suboptimal results. So it will definitely converge, but it might not converge on the global optimum. It might hit the suboptimum. You can use things like K-means plus plus to get around that. Empty clusters, as I mentioned before, like sometimes it's possible that when you run this algorithm, you might get two centroids up on the same point, which basically means you've collapsed one of your groups away. Sometimes that's okay, sometimes it's not. So if you absolutely have to have that, you can tweak your algorithm to delete a cluster and randomly choose another one and keep going. Hyperspherical clusters, what this means is on 2 dimensions, it's a circle. You can think of your clusters as these big circles. But sometimes you might have like 2 interlocking C's like this. Those are the 2 groups that you have. And K-means can't do a very good job of that because it's just measuring distance. You might use a different algorithm like KNN. K nearest neighbors. Outliers, if you have most of your data in clusters, but you have like an outlier, like Lehman Brothers, 149 years before it failed, you would say that you get an outlier. You can use things instead of K-means, you can use K-medians. The median is much more amenable to. And there's no guarantee that it will converge to a global optimum, but we're guaranteed to get some kind of optimum. In general, this is an NP-hard problem. So it's attacked with different kinds of heuristics, and when you come up with a new heuristic, you usually pick one of these weaknesses and attack that and come up with slightly better. So I'm going to skip the second to last slide and just say, in conclusion, I've briefly introduced machine learning and unsupervised learning to K-means in particular. I should know you can easily write it in Q, it's just a few lines, and how you can use it to categorize line color bars. But this algorithm is really powerful because of its simplicity. It's used widely for a variety of different industries. And I hope that this was an interesting application of machine learning to Q and vice versa and encompassing the line. Thank you for your time. Thank you.